It is. It is. It's very quiet. It's a very small place. And it's in the middle of nowhere. Just miles and miles. Just open countryside.
Yeah.
This is looking east to where the Western Front would have been. We've just come from Amiens.
Don't know how he got here, do we? We don't know. I'm trying to guess.
Yeah, where he would have disembarked from the
nothing at all in the
carrier ship.
Maybe we can do some more research on that. But no, on the 6th of April, he arrived here at Villa's Campsort. Is it Campsort? Campsart. Oh, right, I got that as sort. Part of the 20th Division. And the camp were here for, he was here for 4 days. But now we'll go on later, we'll see where he marched to. Marched and, but no, mostly marched, not bust. But yeah, he was here for 4 days. Presumably, it's got to be a big camp, hasn't it?
It has, but it is a very pleasant and peaceful place.
Yeah, yeah. We were saying, weren't we, in the car, that you wouldn't think of any fear really here, would you? Because it is so far from the fighting.
Yeah.
At this part, obviously that would change tomorrow. Right, okay, mate. We're gonna drive through the village now. Called it a village then.
Good, good. I'm glad you don't think it's a town anymore.
And this won't have changed, other than new properties. Nothing would have got shelled during the war because it's too far away from the front.
Yeah, I mean, there's a barn here.
This one on the right?
No, I don't know if it's this one or not, but there was one
that
was really, really old. It looked like it was probably 1,000 years old or something. So.
Yeah, look at this on the left.
It's very much a farming community, isn't it?
It is. And we didn't say, but 6th of April 1918, he was here, came here until the 10th.
So he would have known exactly what to expect on the Western Front at that point in time. So, there's the church.
Yeah, yeah.
There are quite pleasant houses.
Gosh, it is old. Look at this though. The 6th of April was significant because it was the day when Haig did his famous backs to the wall.
Oh, is it?
Command. So the first day
here's another Chateau Chris.
Oh, yeah. And this is the, oh gosh, look at that, yeah.
It's the French memorial, was it?
It was the memorial for the fallen of France. See with the four shells in each corner, yeah.
Can't see, you can catch the cars in the way really.
As long as you've not got my chin. And they'd have seen this, wouldn't they? You did
it. Yeah, here's a really old barn, look.
Okay, yeah, look at that. Looks like it's going to fall down any second. Stood still, isn't it?
It is, yeah.
It's a lot less windy in the car, you know. Okay, and this is where we started from, isn't it? Now there's the sign coming up. So this is us leaving the village.
Leaving Campsart.
Yep.
Thank you.
Yep.
You're going to hazard a guess at the pronunciation? Don't say toe or falls.
Well, that's pretty close to me.
Tufle?
That could be equally as wrong.
But this is another training location, we said, didn't we? I think this was...
Supposedly, but it just seems a very, very strange place to bring a battalion of men.
I know.
It's down quite a steep valley with very, very little on it. But again, it does have quite a nice chateau, so I'm sure it's just that the whoever was the commanding officer of all this just fancied somewhere nice to stay. There's a memorial there to the French, and then we're just going up the hill to the church, and that is all that there seems to be here, really.
I don't know
if you get the impression of how steep it is.
That's the church.
Going up the hill, but
it is just
a quite steeply sided valley.
And all
you're
going to
pull into the church.
Yeah, well, all they did was march them here, train them, then march them another 30 miles, train them, and then throw them at the front.
And as you can see, there's a sign just in front of us saying that you're now out of Tufle. Perhaps that wasn't a good idea. Shot of the valley, then going sweeping past the church. There's just nothing here, really, but it is extremely peaceful.
Beautiful.
So when you consider the horrors that awaited them on the Western Front, it's just unbelievable amount of difference.
Play, and it's all flat on the top here.
Yeah, so it now makes more sense that you might have had a camp up on the top. Hello.
Well, that might happen on his. Yeah, same over here. It's got to be up here, hasn't it?
Yes, I would have thought so. Makes much more sense than, because everywhere coming in from the opposite direction was all quite wavy as well, whereas obviously it's extremely flat up here on the top.
I'm
happy now, I think.
We're in. Do you want me to say where we are, or are you going to say it?
No,
nearer the speaker.
No, I'll give you the pleasure there.
We think it's for Kie. Is that alright?
That's close enough.
And this was in April still, so he's at Villers Campsart, was the first camp where he arrived, and he marched 17 miles up to Tufle. These town names, I'm afraid, and villages are going to be rubbish. And then he marched to here, and this was all about training and reorganising. And I think this is the last place he would have been safe and happy before he went up to the front. I think from here he went up to the sector around Avion and Mericourt, so he would have known this is it, he leaves from here to fight. It's a really nice place, isn't it?
Yes, it's very impressive again. very impressive buildings and chateau and and it's actually for some reason got pictures from just before the First World War dotted about all over the place.
This is brilliant. I mean, what year is that? 1910, did you think that one was?
1909.
Yeah, I can see that.
So obviously that's what it was like then, and this is what it's like now. And there are quite a number of the buildings that you can actually still pick out.
And he was here 5 years after that photograph was taken.
Yeah.
No, sorry, 8 years after that photograph was taken. They want to change much in 8 years.
Right, we're just on top of the hill outside of Kokor.
Yeah.
And he was here in April.
18th of April, yeah, he was spotted here.
So it's just before, just after really, where we were yesterday.
At Fouquier, where they were training.
Yeah.
So they've come here ready to fight, haven't they?
They have, yeah, but they're still quite a little way behind the front lines.
Yeah.
Obviously the anticipation would have grown as they've got closer and closer.
And they were here for 2 weeks, I guess just waiting to be told it was their turn to go up further up front to the front. And the camp, we're guessing, as they get in the fields,
would have been up there, because
somewhere on the top
place itself is actually down in a valley again.
We're just heading down that now.
Yeah. Right, so we're in Carency, and halfway between here and Suchet is
Alberta Camp,
Albert,
which is where he moved up from Kokor, ready to fight, basically. So he's at Alberta Camp, which I think, I'm pretty certain, and the name gives it away, was a Canadian camp, so I'm guessing they just joined it, and they were here then before they were sent up to the front line. So this is the last place. Which are coming up to about a couple of kilometres, would have been the last place before he was sent to the front line.
So again, in trying to figure out exactly where the camp might have been, we're still right between the two villages. but down on the flat ground at the bottom of the valley, there just doesn't seem to be sufficient room to have a mass of soldiers actually in a camp. And the rest of it seems to be very wooded. In the distance there, we think that that is the French Memorial on top of the hill.
Which is a phenomenal part of World War One. You can see the high ground. This is so flat here. You can see the high ground. The Canadians took that. So when Grandad was here, we would have had Vimy Ridge, but that was very late, let's say late on in the year. And you can see why we fought over that, but it was one of the bloodiest battles in the whole world. We've been there, haven't we, Geoff?
Yeah. Very special. We went there last year. As you can see, it's all very flat ground here, and this is the British side, isn't it? This looking south,
yeah.
And then overall, we know that Avion is off to our right, which is over in that direction over there.
Yeah.
So that's where they were actually trying to head towards to take. So I'm just going to go and have a look at Red Trench
which
now.
Is
so we'll just have a look at it on the map.
Yeah, so we're just standing here now. Vimy Ridge is behind us. Here's Red Trench. The town of Avion, as you say, is in front of us. So Red Trench, we've worked out, is this line of where the cars are, and it goes the other side of the road where the houses are. So I think we'll just wander up. It's a really strange feeling having a conversation like this and thinking how what was going on here nearly 100 years ago. Strange, isn't it? Should we walk, see what we can see? What happened at Red Trench? Relieved that the Canadian linkage is strong, isn't it, with Vimy behind us and Alberta camp where he was based. He was here on the 2nd of May as a support position until the 8th of May, so he's here somewhere along here for 6 days, and then moved out from here to Anxious Trench. I mean,
it's not going to fill you with confidence.
No. No, we'll do that after here, but I'm guessing we're saying if we take the bit on the right, I think the bit on the left is now just housing. There's kind of no lining, but it just feels really eerie, Geoff.
Yeah.
Somewhere across here.
So it might actually be the road, or it might just be this edge of the field,
the smaller ground, yeah. And he's staying, in effect, he's 6 days here just waiting to hear whether he's going up to the front line. You know, yeah.
Well, again, he would have heard it all, wouldn't he?
Massively.
Because it's very close. We've just come through Abbeyon to get to here, and it's only less than a mile away, really. So we're just looking around here at the moment, trying to get some landmarks as to where we might have actually been here at the time. And we've got this back again, the Bent Trench is Bois de la Chandière. Well done, it looks like. And we think that some remnants of that just over there in the distance. So if he'd have been in this particular trench, then he would have actually been able to look over at that wood. I think that's probably the only landmark that we can actually pick out.
Yeah, that's right.
Obviously the forests and what have you more in the background would have been there, and the ridge, but particularly that one there is the sort of closest landmark, I think. Right, so we've come along the D55 road now because we're in search of Anxious Trench. Uh-huh. In the distance, hopefully, you can see the end of the housing estate, which was on a line, we think, with Red Trench. And we think this line of trees that you can see here is the most likely positioning of Anxious Trench.
Yeah.
So how come he came to be in this one then, Chris?
Well, he was 6 days on the from the 2nd of May, he was 6 days in Red Trench. Then on the 8th of May, they relieved the 12th KRRC in the front line and outpost. So this was the headquarters in Anxious Trench that we're looking at now. But he was here a long time. I think he's here 12 days. And the records show that the first night he was here, sent out active patrols and worked in the trenches. The 15th of May came under heavy fire from gas. Now, I know he was gassed, but clearly he was not injured here, so he must have had his gas mask on, because it was September when he was injured. But it was his first taste of the horror of what that must have been like. So under heavy fire 15th of May, and didn't leave here until the 20th of May, when they were relieved by the 2nd Scottish Rifles, and went back to Alberta camp again.
We've now just driven around the back, haven't we, Geoff, and I were talking earlier, so we think we're at probably Anxious Trench. You think
it's... Well, it's difficult to tell, isn't it? There's three features on the map. We think that this is the most likely one, because we're trying to overlay it with the direction that the road actually went, and there's a distinctive kink in the road, so we think that that... I think really leads into this trench, but equally it could be the line above us there. Going along that line above us there, if you go to the end of the houses, the end of the houses really is where we were looking at Red Trench, and we know that we're slightly northwest of Red Trench, so all we can really say, I think, a degree of confidence is somewhere in this area.
Yeah.
So we probably got within 50 yards of whichever trench it actually was. But these are really quite distinctive markers in what else is miles and miles afield. These seem to be, there's a set of outline of trees which would perhaps indicate a ditch or certainly a change in land level.